Good day, students. Welcome to math.serve.com. In this clip, we're going to be going over part two of the May 2014 STAAR exam for Algebra 1. We're going to be doing problems 6 to 10 in this installment. Let's take a look at question 6. It says, a college student needs 11 classes that are worth a total of 40 credits in order to complete her degree. The college offers both 4 credits classes and 3 credit classes. Which system of equations can be used to determine F, the number of 4 credit classes the student can take to complete her degree, and H, the number of 3 credit classes, of course, she can take to complete her degree. Okay, so this is a straightforward question. F is the number of 4 credit classes and H is the number of 3 credit classes. So we're going to be setting up 2 equations here. The first equation will be the number of classes. So let's write that down. Number of classes. So we have two sets of classes, right? We have the 4 credit classes and the 3 credit classes. How many of each? We have F, 4 credit classes, plus H, 3 credit classes, gives you the total amount of classes, which is she needs 11 classes in all. Okay, so that's the first equation. The second equation is the number of credits. Okay, so for the 4 credit classes, she's going to take F, 4 credit classes, giving us a total of 4 times F credits. And then she's going to take H, 3 credit classes, giving us a total of 3 H credits. Okay, the total number of credits she's taken overall is 40 credits, so we have 40 credits there. So this is a system of equations we need to solve in order to find the total number of 4 credit classes and 3 credit classes she needs to take to graduate. All right. So let's see what the correct answer is. We can clearly see that the correct answer is option letter J. Okay, let's take a look at question number 7. It says the graph shows the time it took a worker to package 16 bottles of shampoo. Okay, so we have the time versus the number of shampoo bottles that we packaged. And the question is as follows. The next day, 2 workers packaged twice the number of bottles of shampoo in the same amount of time. If this new relationship is graphed on the same coordinate grid, which statement is true? So instead of graphing, for example, 2 bottles in 5 hours, the amount doubled to 4 bottles in 5 hours. Okay, so how will that new set of situation affect the graph? One thing you want to note, having the same y-intercept of 0, if this graph goes in this direction towards the if it goes towards the x-axis, the graph is going to become less steep. Okay, it's going to become less steep because this line right here has 0 steepness. Okay, it has no steepness. So the closer a line is to a horizontal orientation, the less steep it becomes. Let me give you a visual. So let's say you have a line like this, and if it's going down like this, it's becoming less steep. And then when it gets to 0, it has no steepness. When it goes down, it has negative steepness. All right, so keep that in mind. Now, if the line is getting closer to the y-axis, keeping the same y-intercept, if it's heading in that direction, it's going to be more steep or steeper, okay? So it's going to be steeper. Let me show you a visual. So if we have a line like this, the closer it gets to the y-axis, at the y-axis you have infinite steepness, right? So the closer it gets to the y-axis, the steeper it becomes. So in this situation, the number of bottles packaged doubles for every time here. So for the new line, for 5 minutes, we have, instead of two, we have four. We're just gonna grab some points, all right? For 10, instead of four, we have eight. Let's see if we can graph another one. For 15, instead of, for 15, we have six. Instead of six, we have 12. Let's go ahead and graph our new line. So our new line is going to look something like this. All right, so let's just connect the dots. So if I connect the dots for the new line, it's gonna look something like this. All right, so what's the situation here? If you look at this line, is it steeper or less steep? Since it's closer to the y-axis, we can see that it's much steeper than this line, okay? So let's see, look at our options. The new graph will have a y-intercept of 80. That's not true, the y-intercept does not change. The new graph would be steeper than the original graph. Voila, that's exactly what we have, okay? The new graph, as we can see here, this is the new graph, is steeper than the original graph. So we can see that the answer is option letter B. All right, let's take a look at question 8. It says the side length of the figure below is given in centimeters. If the perimeter of the figure is 78 centimeters, what is the value of X? So what is the perimeter of this figure? It's simply the sum of all the sides, okay? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you have 5 sides. The sum of all 5 sides. Okay, so let's go ahead and write it down. We have x squared plus 2x minus 3 plus 2x minus 3 plus 12 plus 2x. I just added these sides, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all these 5 sides, all right? And we're told that it's equal to 78, so we set it equal to 78. Now what we're going to do is combine like terms in this equation. Let's go ahead and do it. So we have, let's combine the squares first. We have just one square. So we have x squared. And then let's combine the first degree terms. We have 2x plus 2x plus 2x. 2 plus 2 plus 2 is 6, so we have plus 6x. And then we have negative 3 minus 3 minus 3 plus 12. So minus 3 minus 3 is minus 6, and then when we add 12, we end up with plus 6, okay? So we have plus 6 equals 78. Now before you solve a quadratic, you want to have it in standard form, or set it equal to 0. So to do that, we'll subtract 78 from both sides to set it equal to 0. And then that yields x squared plus 6x minus 72 equals 0. Okay? Now, let's solve this. We can solve this by factoring. So we're going to make the x gain. AC goes on top, and then B goes on the bottom. Okay, so AC is negative 72 in this case, and B is 6. Now, what two numbers multiply to give you negative 72 and add to give you 6? Let's figure it out. Let's write down the pairs of numbers that multiply to give us 72 and see which pair can be combined to yield 6. Okay? So we have 72. 1 times 72 is 72. 2 times 36 is 72. If you combine these two, you get 34 or 38. That doesn't work. 3 times 24 will give us 72. If you add these two, you get 27. If you subtract it, you get 21. That doesn't work. 4 times, let's see. 4 goes there once, 18. So if you combine these, you get 22. If you subtract, you get 14. That doesn't work. 6 times 12. Wait, voila, this pair works perfectly, okay? All right, so let's go ahead and input these pairs. We have a combination of 6 and 12. Since the sum is positive and the product is negative, that means the smaller of the two must be negative. Now let's go ahead and factor this. It's simply going to be x minus 6 times x plus 12. Now some students equals 0. Some students will say, oh wait, the answer is negative 6 or positive 12, right? But that doesn't work. We're not done solving the problem yet. We want to get x by itself. So to accomplish that, we are going to set both factors to 0. This is called the zero product property. To get x by itself here, we have x equals positive 6. And this, how did I do that? I added 6 to both sides. And then over here, I'm going to subtract 12 from both sides. And I'll get x equals 12, negative 12. Now we're talking about side lengths. Which answer does not make sense and which answer makes sense? Side lengths are always positive, so the negative answer does not make sense. So we can scrap that. Our correct answer is going to be 6. Okay, that is the value of x, 6, okay? So that's that. All right, let's take a look at question 9. It says, one type of redwood tree has an average height of 65 feet when it is 20 years old. If the tree is more than 20 years old, the average height h can be modeled by the function h equals 1.95 times a minus 20 plus 65, where a is the age of the tree in years. Which statement about this situation is true? So this is a type of problem where looking at the options can help you zero in on the component of the equation that is relevant. All right, so let's go ahead and write down the equation again. We have h equals 1.95 times a minus 20 plus 60. Now this right here, if you remember the point slope equation of a line, this kind of looks like the slope, 1.95. All right, and then this kind of looks like y1, and then this looks like x1. So let's go ahead and look at what we have here. In this problem, you notice 1.95 shows up. It shows up here again, shows up here again. So it's important for us to really understand what 1.95 is in the context of this problem, all right? Or else we might not be able to get the correct answer. So 1.95 can be viewed as the rate at which the tree grows every year. It grows by about 1.95 feet. Okay, think about the rise over run as your slope. For every 1.9 feet it rises, the run or the time change is 1 year. That's the slope right here. That is after 65 years. Not every single year, is after 65 years. Then for every 20 years, after 65 feet, for every 20 years it grows, you have 1.95 feet increased, okay? Every year over 20. So let's take a look at these options and see the one that matches. Option letter A. It says every additional 1.95 feet of length over 20 feet adds 45 years to the age of this type of redwood tree. So let's take a look at that for a second. So this doesn't match the description here because 1.9, we have 1.9 feet per year. Okay, that's the rate at which it increases. 1.9 feet here doesn't indicate that growth rate here. Here it's telling you it adds 45 every year, which is false. Okay, so this answer doesn't match our understanding of 1.95 feet as the growth rate. Okay, so remember, this is feet every year. Now the second one says, for this type of redwood tree, the average height increases by 1.9 feet per year throughout its lifetime. Okay, now let's take a look at that. That looks pretty good, 1.9 feet per year. That's the slope right there. But wait a minute, it says throughout its lifetime. Well, that's not true. There are conditions. Remember, we have to start with 65 feet, and for every 20 years more, all right, the average height it gains is 1.9 feet per year. So this statement right here, throughout the lifetime, that's wrong. Okay, so that basically makes this, it's close, but it's wrong. Let's look at option C. It says each additional year of age over 20 years adds 1.9 feet to the average height of the tree. So each year, you gain 1.9 feet after 20 years, exactly what we want. Okay, so after 20 years, you gain 1.95 feet per year. So the answer is option letter C. Just some additional points to help you understand the reasoning behind the problem like this. If you consult your reference, your forms of linear equation on your reference materials, you're going to come across this formula y minus y1 equals mx minus x1. So this equation is exactly the same as this. It's just in a different form. Okay, m is a slope. So we can see that this is a slope right here. So that's a growth rate. Okay, this is your x1, and this is your y1, and this is y1 also. The reason why this is negative is because it is on the left side of the equation. So if you see an equation set up like this, it's similar to the y minus y1 equals mx minus x1. Okay? So just keep that in mind. All right, let's take a look at question number 10. It says the mapping below represents all the points on the graph of the function f. What is the domain? So you have to remember that if you have a mapping notation like this of a function, we have input and outputs, okay? So the x's are the inputs, and these are the outputs, all right? So the set of inputs represent your domain. Don't forget, domain is the x's. And then the outputs represent your range, okay, the y's. So since the question is asking for the domain, all we'll just simply do is list all the inputs in a set notation, and that will be our domain, okay? So domain is, let's put it in ascending order, negative 4, negative 1, 0, 2, 7. That's your domain. Option letter F is the correct answer, okay? So that's that. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this presentation. We really appreciate it. Feel free to subscribe to our channel for updates to the remainder of this review series. More clips can be found on mathgodserve.com. And do post a comment to let us know what you think about this tutorial or if you need support on other math concepts. Thanks again for watching and have a wonderful day.